I'm the VP of Digital Operations for Bonnier Corporation. I want to talk with you a little bit about our experience with Gigya and Field and Stream and Outdoor Life. These are two of our largest magazines, and we recently went through the process of redesigning both titles online and integrating Gigya as our customer identity management solution. So a couple things about me, just quickly. In the role of VP for Digital Operations, I oversee a 40-person team of developers, quality assurance analysts, project managers, ad operations staff. But my background is actually in digital journalism, having worked for a number of large publishers. And on the screen is one of my favorite projects, which is PolitiFact, where I was one of the project managers for that. The reason I stress the journalism aspect of this is customer identity management, in my opinion, is not just a technical concern. For publishers, this should not be something that the web development and the IT departments are alone responsible for. To really be thinking about the opportunities and responsive to what our users need, it has to be something that journalism, marketing, other areas of the business are owning. So over the last 3 years, we've redesigned 50 digital properties. It's a huge undertaking for us, but we knew that going into the future for digital, we couldn't be in the position where we had a lot of different technology systems. Bonnier used to have properties on Drupal, on WordPress, on Java, and we consolidated, and we built them all around a custom Drupal CMS. This is a theme you'll hear me come back to throughout the presentation, which is we really wanted to standardize and look at best-in-class solutions and think hard about our core competencies. And when something wasn't for Bonnier to try to have a core competency in it, we looked for the right partner. And that's part of the reason we chose Gigya. And as I mentioned, we have more than 50 digital properties, and we have 30 multi-channel brands that are driving those. These are among Bonnier's properties. And you can tell by the slide, we're covering motorcycles, boating, outdoor properties, destination weddings and honeymoons. It really does run the gamut for us. But the needs for personalization, for a better understanding of our customers, cuts across all of these different properties. A little bit about Field and Stream. The image that you're seeing on screen right now is the old site. Field and Stream is the world's leading outdoor magazine. And the site that we had pretty much been the same for about 6 years. And in digital terms, that's a long time. So we knew when we redesigned the site, we had an opportunity for major upgrades. And looking at how we'd position ourselves to better serve the users was an important aspect of it. Field and Stream is really for outdoor enthusiasts where we try to cultivate kind of a broad competence. Fishing, hunting, a lot of areas of really getting the most out of the outdoor experience. This is Field and Stream as we relaunched it on October 12th. And there are a lot of unsurprising kind of standard goals that we pursued with this redesign. We wanted larger photos and illustrations. We wanted to do a better job with digital storytelling and create some more immersive experiences. We wanted fewer advertising units, but higher viewability for those units. We wanted to bring more value to our advertisers. And we also, of course, wanted it to be a faster loading site and have a better mobile experience. And I think we hit on a lot of those, and I'll show you some metrics in a minute that speak to that point. But we also wanted to set the framework for having deeper relationships with our audience, for being able to better serve the readers. How do we really start to understand our readers individually and tailor the experience to them? So I mentioned, we are looking at our core competencies, looking at our strengths, and identifying, is something in our wheelhouse or is it not? And when we thought about the idea of a customer identity management system, we had a number of options. One of them was to maintain our existing system, which was a Drupal-based system. But we're really playing off of Drupal's user system. It wasn't really the right solution to scale for us across a lot of properties. We had limited ability with social logins, and so we knew we needed to expand that as well. And as we began our search, as we started talking with a lot of different providers, Gigya quickly emerged for us as a very viable partner. And we looked at all the strengths of the Gigya platform. We saw Gigya's core competency in this area. We knew the support existed for social logins, for mobile, for cross-site single sign-on, and I'll get to in a minute why that's so important, especially for Bonnier. Also important to us were all the pre-built integrations. The ability for us to look at our analytics, our ad serving, our email systems, many of which were kind of siloed, and think about how can we leverage all of that data and all of those capabilities. And then also, where could we maybe save a little bit in terms of development work? And looking at the fact that Gigya had comments and review and gamification functionality that we could leverage. So 1 month after Field and Stream relaunched, we started to hit some of those metrics that were important to us. We saw a 54% increase in page views, 14% increase in MVVs. We lowered the bounce rate, meaning the visits that were coming to the site that were only looking at one page and then leaving. We increased those page views per visit, and importantly, we also saw over 1,000 new registrations on Gigya. And one of the reasons that's significant for us is because we weren't seeing that same volume beforehand. The registration process was a little bit clunky. It wasn't that inviting. And with Gigya in place, it became more streamlined for us. Outdoor life, similar in some regards to Field and Stream, obviously, they're covering a lot of the same subject matter. But still, you look at that site experience and you can see there's a lot we're trying to pack into the real estate on screen, and we're probably not doing enough justice to some of those features. So again, we relaunched Outdoor Life. We relaunched Outdoor Life just 2 weeks after Field and Stream, so we leveraged a lot of the same work. And with this now being launched, and with Field and Stream already out there, it started to allow us to have deeper conversations, thinking about what are those customizable experiences that we can have? How can we start to regionalize the editorial content on the site? So if we know someone's living in Seattle, Washington, and they're an outdoor enthusiast, they're probably not going to be that interested in the hunting conditions in Virginia. But how do we start to tailor that experience to them a little bit more? Also key for us, and I think very true for a lot of publishers, is the advertising experience. All of you, I'm sure, have those sites that you know you visit where you get barraged by advertisements, all types of ad units that are kind of interrupting that experience. Again, we wanted to take the volume of the ad units down, serve fewer, but make that advertising experience more tailored and give our advertisers better viewability for their units. And how do we then create, really, Field and Stream and Outdoor Life are already kind of niche publications. How do we create these hyper niche communities based, again, on what people are experiencing on the site and where they live? So all of this starts to come into play when we're leveraging the Gigya platform. So again, 1 month later, page views are up 69%, and you can see some of the other metrics. And Outdoor Life is a smaller property than Field and Stream. So we saw fewer registrations, but very importantly, we had cross-site registration. So for someone who registered for Field and Stream, they automatically had an account with Outdoor Life, and vice versa. And this is something we plan to carry forward for a lot of our properties. Who are those users for our titles? They're incredibly engaged. You're looking at the screen, and if you can see, we have people who have points ranging on those examples from over 900,000 to 5 million. People gain points on our sites by commenting on stories, by participating in questions and answers sections, asking questions, answering questions of other users. There is a true sense of belonging for the people that are on these websites. And as you can see, these communities go back 7, 8 years that we have members who've been participating. It's very self-policing, but it's also a community that cares very deeply about that user experience. And so when we look at the community, it's not just that collection of users. It's truly people that have a relationship with one another and a relationship with our editors and our advertising partners through the vehicle that is Bonnier's Field and Stream and Outdoor Life sites. All in, we have 250,000 registered users for our site. We have more than 350,000 answers that have been added to Field and Stream in response to user questions, and another 75,000 on Outdoor Life. We're leveraging Gigya to be able to have profiles for these individuals, to be able to have that question and answer functionality enabled. It's not only been a benefit from a development standpoint, but we know that there's strength going forward because we have a strong partner in Gigya to be able to provide this functionality. In total, all of our users have amassed more than 81 million points. Now granted, some of this predates the use of Gigya, for sure, but the fact that we now have a platform that we can scale, that's reliable going forward, positions us to serve these users in so many better ways. People are gaining those points in increments of about 10 to 500 points, depending on actions. So when you do the math, that adds up to a very engaged community. So all of that said, great, we've redesigned the sites, they look better, we've got the Gigya integration. What does this really do for us? So we look at, can we now answer some of these questions that otherwise are just very difficult for us to reconcile? What are the percentage, what percentage of our engaged users with a given brand are engaged with us on more than one channel? What percentage of the Bonnier audience engages across multiple brands? And who are our most valuable users? Once we can kind of identify these patterns and see who the most important ones are, see how they're engaging with us across so many different verticals, now we can start to serve them better. So for us, activating that user data really comes down to the UX. And again, this is one of the things that we looked at when considering partners. It's not just about registering on the site to participate in the communities and to add comments. We're moving toward being able to have one single portal for people to manage their print and digital subscriptions, to register for events that our brands run, to register for contests, to manage their email newsletter subscriptions. And Patrick showed you a slide that had a lot of different technologies listed on it. These are some of the things we use every day to power our sites. DoubleClick for ad serving, Adobe Analytics, Crux, Silverpop for email. We wanted to be able to leverage the power of those and kind of have one picture of our full user base. So we're working on integrations with all of those systems as well. The strategy is actually fairly simple if you think about it just in terms of collecting, organizing, and activating the data. But the problem for so many publishers is their technology stacks tend to evolve in a very piecemeal fashion. You have a problem, you acquire a technology solution, you put it in place, you use it, maybe somebody's owning it to some degree, and then you have the next opportunity or the next problem and you add another technology to it. But do you really have a way to be able to activate the data across all of these systems? Sport fishing. Marlin, saltwater sportsmen, and boating. These are four other Bonnier brands, and you can see that there's already similarities in the type of coverage that they would have, the type of users that we would try to address. And so I showed you this slide earlier, a number of the Bonnier Corp brands. And again, they run the gamut, and this is only a handful of them. But next, we're starting to look at, well, okay, if we have single sign-on across those two properties, and we're gathering data and we're using that to better inform some of the editorial coverage, how we deploy resources, what if we start to add a few more properties to that? What if we now start to have more complementary brands where we're collecting user information, and now that's giving us a wider scope of information to draw upon? Again, for us, that was very difficult up until we saw the potential with the customer identity management system. One of the biggest conversations that I think any publisher faces, and this was definitely true for us, in a world where there's so many technology solutions, there's such competitive pressure in the media industry in terms of financials and opportunities and what do you embrace next, is really thinking about the organizational readiness to move toward a customer identity management system. And more broadly, what does it really mean to be investing in data as a publisher? There's always that temptation to kind of look at, well, what's the least expensive option? What kind of gets us in the game? And obviously doing that, choosing the least expensive option for anything can always have negative connotations, can have negative effect on you. So part of what we did was we really focused our search on value. It wasn't about price per se, it was about what are you getting in return for that investment. While we started with Field and Stream and Outdoor Life, we also had to think about the project as being bigger than any couple brands. It really had to be a investment from the company in data. So yes, there are a couple sites that we wanted to relaunch, and we knew we wanted to replace our internal system, but we had to think about what were going to be applications years down the road. We also needed to balance internal discussions about capabilities versus expectations. If you do such a good job sometimes explaining what the potential is within the organization, the downside is that some people would think, great, I'll sell into that tomorrow. When's it ready? When can I activate that data? And we had to recognize that this was going to be an investment that would start to pay some dividends right away, that we'd be able to see some value, but it might take a little while before we activate it fully across all of our properties. We also had to look for a product owner for it. And again, for publishers, this can be tough. It's very easy to be able to rally people together to be part of an implementation team, but it's a little harder sometimes to be able to recognize that there has to be a true owner for the system and for the service going forward. So that was also a key discussion point for us. Last but not least, we had to look at who was really owning this organizationally. I mentioned at the top, part of the reason that it's very important that, you know, I'm speaking a little bit from the editorial perspective when we're looking at digital operations, is it can't just be a technical system. When you're thinking about customer identity management, for us, we knew it couldn't just be a web and IT conversation. It had to be something more holistic. If we didn't have the buy-in from our brands, if they weren't seeing the potential on an editorial, advertising, and marketing perspective, it wasn't going to pay off for us. We weren't going to get the most out of this system. So we had to have that holistic conversation as a company. And then why? Through all of this vetting, all of this examination, all of these internal discussions, what led us to choose Gigya? There's a number of factors. It wasn't any one thing, but when we started adding it up, when we started doing our kind of internal score sheets, it became pretty evident. One of the things that was very attractive to us was the balance between media and non-media companies. In digital publishing, you never know what's going to be the next opportunity. For Bonnier Corp, you think about magazines, you think about websites, but events is a very big part of our business. OTT video becomes a very increasingly important part of the business. So we had to look at what were going to be the products, the channels that we served our audience going forward. The readiness to guide us through conversations we weren't ready to have internally. Again, we had an internal system that we'd used, and we'd had some piecemeal offerings, but to be able to see some of that long-term potential, to know what was happening in the industry. And I'll mention just two others. You can kind of read through the remainder, but that agile, iterative delivery process was very important. Again, when you're making that investment, you want to be able to see some returns right away. And I think Gigya's approach was momentum-focused for us. We talked quite a bit about that first win within 90 days. If you're going to invest in a significant system such as customer identity management, you want to be able to have wins, to be able to keep that organizational interest high, to be able to keep people engaged in the process. That mattered to us, and again, we're a little over 30 days in with two of our sites, and those conversations have already broadened for us. Actually, I will mention one more, which is that last bullet point. That successful implementation was just, frankly, the beginning of this relationship for us. Again, project-based for Field and Stream and Outdoor Life, but it really opens a broader conversation.